Hi again, everyone. Chris Tisdell here again. In this presentation, I'm going to continue my series of videos on complex numbers. Now, in previous videos, we looked at some basic properties of complex numbers, the conjugate, the modulus, and all the forms of complex numbers that we looked at were of the Cartesian form, the x plus yi form. In this presentation, I'm going to show you a new way of writing complex numbers called a polar trig form. So I'll show you what it is, I'll show you why it's useful, and we'll look at a basic example. So let me share my screen with you and we can start. Okay, so like I said, up until now we've been dealing with this Cartesian form, x plus yi, where x is, x and y are real, x is called the real part of the complex number, y is called the imaginary part. Sometimes it's convenient to express complex numbers in other equivalent forms, especially for giving geometric meaning and also simplifying calculations like powers and products and things like this. Okay, so we're going to introduce a new way of writing a complex number called the polar trigonometric form, or just the polar trig form for short. Some books call it the polar form, but to be definite, I'm going to call it the polar trig form. Okay, so let's talk about what the form is. I can write each complex number in terms of a length, which is going to be r, and an angle, theta. Okay, and in particular, the r is a distance to the origin from the point associated with the complex number, and theta is the angle to the positive real axis. And so this is based on polar coordinates, where you have two variables. You have a length and an angle, so r and theta respectively. Okay, so let me draw a little freehand diagram here. Imagine this is your complex plane, sometimes called an Argand diagram. And let's say you've got you've plotted your complex number in the imaginary the complex plane. Okay, so let's draw a little line segment from the origin to that point. Okay, the length of that little line segment is going to be r, and the angle to the positive real axis, or this part of the horizontal axis, is going to be the angle there is going to be the theta. Okay, now if we rotate around anti-clockwise, theta increases. And if we go the other way, theta decreases. And when we're on the real axis, the theta zero. The positive real axis, theta zero. Okay, so each complex number z has a polar trig form given by this, where r can be computed using Pythagoras' theorem. Okay, so if you sort of go down here, this is, if this will be sort of say x, and this will be yi. Okay, you've got a right angle triangle. Okay, so this, I guess this distance here will be y, this distance here will be x, and so r is just the square root of x squared plus y squared. Okay, also denoted by this modulus of z. And if you use trigonometry here, you can show that x equals r cos theta, y equals r sine theta, and so tan theta is just y over x. Now, the angle theta is denoted by arg of z, okay, with a little a, and we call theta an argument of z. All right, so if you were, say, given a complex number in Cartesian form, where you knew x and y, you can immediately compute r, and you can compute the argument of z as well. Okay, now a couple of things. You might say we call it an argument of z. Shouldn't it be the argument? Well, not really, because you can have lots of angles. In fact, an infinite number of angles associated with each complex number, which is a little bit strange. So let me talk about that a bit more. Okay, and the reason is that cosine and sine are periodic functions with period 2 pi. Okay, so it's basically cosine and sine are functions that repeat, and they repeat themselves every 2 pi units. Okay, so because of this, the angle theta associated with the complex number is not unique. So let me just actually show you on a diagram why that's true. So let's say I go up here, I've got my complex number, point plotted in the complex plane. If I go up here, so I rotate a little bit, I'll get up to there. But if I do another rotation, a whole 2 pi or 360 degrees, we usually use radians here, I can get back to that z again. And if I do another complete revolution, I can get back to that z again. Okay, so if theta is an angle associated with your complex number z, then theta plus 2k pi for each integer k is also an angle associated with z. All right, let me give you a definite example here. Suppose I've got the complex number z equals 1 plus I. Okay, so I'm going to plot that in the complex plane, and using Pythagoras, I know that the length there is going to be root 2, and using trig, the angle to the positive real axis is going to be pi on 4. But I know that I can spin around one more time, 2 pi radians, and I'll be back in the same place as long as I haven't changed the length. So these are two ways of representing the number 1 plus I. Okay, and it comes down to cosine, this being equal to this, and this being equal to this. Cosine and sine are both periodic with period 2 pi. I mean, you can break this down into pi on 4 plus 2 pi and pi on 4 plus 2 pi. Okay, so there are an infinite way of representing the same complex number in these polar trig forms, and that's because of the angle. Okay, so we conclude that theta, or the argument, argz with a lowercase a, is not uniquely determined when given a complex number z. Okay, so this is a bit worrying, but let's put some definiteness in here. Okay, we're going to now define what is known as the principal argument of z. Okay, and in particular, the principal argument gives us definiteness, and we still call it argz, but we put a capital A in. And here's the basic idea. The principal argument of a complex number is always between negative pi and pi. That's really the take-home message here. Okay? So that's the important thing. All right? So although an argument can be lots of different things, the principal argument will have one and only one value. Because we're restricting it to the range negative pi to pi. Okay? So given any argument with a lowercase a associated with a complex number, we can always work on that by, say, taking away an integer of 2 pi so that this value, or the principal argument, lies between negative pi and pi. Okay, so let me show you an example of how this works. And you know, if we were saying, you know, if you were given a question, for example, saying, "Oh, write you're given some sort of, let's say you're given a complex number z, 1 plus I, write it in simplified polar trig form, okay? You wouldn't write this down because the angle here isn't between negative pi and pi. You would write this down because the angles there are between, both between a negative pi and pi. So let me just sort of whip up a quick example for you and show you what it's like. So here, the args are different with a lowercase a, but the principal args are the same for these things. It's pi on 4. Okay, so let me just whip up a quick example. Okay, so let's consider the following polar trig form. Cos focus right. Yep. I'm just focusing here. Okay. Cos 5 pi on 2 plus I sine 5 pi on 2. Okay. Now, you can see that this is not in the simplified polar trig form because the angles here are not between negative pi and pi. Okay, so in this case, an argument associated with this form is 5 pi on 2, but 5 pi on 2 is not between negative pi and pi. Okay, so what we can do is break this up into an angle that's between pi on negative pi and pi on 2 plus or minus some multiple of 2 pi, say. Okay, so I can actually do this and write it in the following way. Okay, so 5 pi on 2. If I take a pi on 2 out of there, I'm left with 4 pi on 2 plus pi on 2 Okay, now 4 pi on 2 is just 2 pi. So we know that cosine and sine are both periodic with period 2 pi. So this will disappear and this will disappear. So I'll get the following. Okay, so now this is written in the simplified polar trig form. Okay? Now you can, of course, you can simplify it further. Now, you may think, well, how do I know how to break that up? Well, this is just the algebra. If you draw a picture, it's actually sometimes even easier. Okay. Okay, so I know from this two, let's start with this again and forget about the rest of that. I know from the two out there, I go out 2 units from the origin. And then it's just how much do I rotate? Okay, so 5 pi on 2. What is 5 pi on 2? Well, 5 pi on 2 is one rotation. Oh, will take us back to where we started, right? That will give us 2 pi. Okay, and then I'm left with another pi on 2. So I rotate another pi on 2 units. So I know that actually this will take me 2 units from the origin, and I'll be sitting on the imaginary axis. Okay? So sometimes it's easier just to actually draw a little picture and just rotate, okay? So I knew, okay, 5 pi on 2, go around 2 pi units, that's one revolution, and then I'll be left with pi on 2, so another quarter term. Okay, so up here, of course, z would be 2i. All right, now if we were rotating the other way, you would have negative value. So if you were going, say, negative 5 pi on 2, you would go the opposite way. You would go clockwise. You would do one revolution clockwise and then keep going another quarter of a turn. So if we had, say, cos negative 5 pi on 2 plus I sine negative 5 pi on 2, all times by 2, you would end up down here at negative 2i. Okay? Now, there are other ways of writing complex numbers using lengths and angles. Okay? There's also, instead of this form, which I've called the polar trig form, there's also a way using an exponential function. Okay, some books also refer to that as a polar form, but I'm going to call that a polar exponential form. Okay, so we'll look at that in the next video and see how that can help us too. Okay, so that's my presentation. Hope you enjoyed it. So we're now moving into a new area where we're using lengths and angles to describe complex numbers. And the reason is that they will simplify some calculations and they give us an easy geometric way of placing points in the complex plane or on an Argand diagram. So in the next video, I'm going to talk about the polar exponential form, which again involves a length and an angle. So I hope you can tune in for that presentation. If you have any comments, any questions, you can put them in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. Bye.